Das 103.7 Unser Ding, Hallberg Open Air 2013.
Der große internationale Act beim Hallberg Open Air 2013 sitzt jetzt bei mir auf der Couch. Royal Republic aus Schweden, mal wieder der beste Beweis dafür, dass es die Skandinavier faustdick hinter den Ohren haben, was Musik angeht. Welcome, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here. How do you like it here? Have you been to Saarland once
before?
We have
on a number of occasions, actually, yes.
So what is pretty about the Saarland,
part of
Germany?
I think the main thing we took from Saarland was the Schwenken thing. Because we did that in the middle of the street. The first time we went to Saarland or Saarbrücken, we had like a big Schwenkel in the middle of the street and people just getting us all kinds of awesome sausages and meats and stuff like that. So we took it and we made a word out of it, like Schwenken. Yeah. We turned it into like an adjective for something good. So we were all like, if we see a nice car, we would be like, that is one Schwenken car.
Oh.
And we used it like all the time, and our support acts totally like adopted it and took it. And one of the guys from a band called Tracer actually got Schwenken tattooed all over his stomach. It's like the worst.
Thank you for making us
useless.
Famous.
Yeah, well,
thank you very much. So now you're here to play on the stage, and you're also here to save the nation. At least that's the title of your album. So I just guess you're the Messiah. What are your plans to save the world?
What are your plans to save the world?
Yeah.
I don't know.
You don't know.
Excellent.
So you came here without any plans.
No, it's not so much about saving the world, actually. It's more about, Hannes usually describes it very well, it's about an inner salvation, right?
An inner salvation. Can you tell me more about it? Save the nation.
Well, that's about it. I mean, there's no like big meaning behind it. It was just, you know, an awesome song and a good title for the album, so that's about it.
Okay. It just sounds great.
Yeah, at least one.
Okay, so you're on tour, you're here, and while playing on tour, you hop from airport to airport, and sometimes you shoot little videos. Like there was one of you at an airport, I don't know where, but you told the people that you forgot to brush your teeth. Dirty mouth. Did you brush them this morning?
Actually, I did, yes.
You did?
Yeah,
can
it was
you,
awesome. I didn't brush them last night. I don't think I brushed them the night before that either.
Oh,
I'm such a baby because I...
such a pig.
No, but I hate doing stuff. I hate washing my hands before I eat.
Okay.
I do it, but it's like, oh, not again.
No, you can do it afterwards in case you spill.
And when you're tired, you want to go to bed. You're like, oh, I got to fucking brush my teeth now and get undressed and do all this stuff. I got to... Yeah, it's boring.
So you always have chewing gum in your pockets?
No, I don't. I don't.
You don't.
I don't do chewing gum.
Have a dirty mouth.
I just and I haven't been to the dentist either in about 3 years because I didn't have a time to make an appointment.
Yeah.
For touring, so it's probably a mess in there.
Okay, but we're happy you did this morning. So, how do you prepare for tours shows?
Preparing for tours...
Besides brushing your teeth.
No, preparing for tours is still a bit weird. No matter how many times we've like gone on tour, I still have the same kind of vibe. A few days before I go on tour, I get a bit stressed out and I have trouble listening when people talk. I'm like in my own mind. Just, what did you say, you know? I don't know. It's some kind of automatic mental preparation, I guess, for going on the road. Before the shows, it's pretty much us looking like zombies. We're just sitting around and doing nothing, you know. And then we have to like force start it because I don't know. Maybe I think that's also some kind of automatic like energy conservation thing.
Okay.
I think because we need a lot of energy when we go on stage. So we spend like the last few hours before the show just... Okay.
Going to bed.
You know.
I thought that you guys at least play a round of ping pong.
Oh, that we do. Yeah.
I heard that your tour bus has a fold-out ping pong table. Is that true?
We bought one. It's about the size of this table. It's not like a real ping pong table. But we invented this amazing game called Rumbleton the other day.
How does it work? Tell it.
It works like you have a ping pong table and you put two cups like on each side, and you serve. You're supposed to serve into the opponent's cup. And the cup is filled with rum. So when you score, like when you put it in the other guy's cup, they have to like...
Drink it.
And then another player comes along and we scream, Rumbleton, Rumbleton. And it's a lot of fun.
So we're glad you didn't do it before the show.
Oh, we will. Don't worry.
You will.
Yeah.
So you always get drunk on
yeah, totally. Yeah, we do all
stage.
Kinds of drugs and stuff.
The whole time. Right now.
Hardcore. Yeah, I'm high.
Okay, so no ping pong yet, but maybe later. and you're playing on stages throughout Europe. What is more fun for you, to play in front of international crowds like here in Germany or to play at home?
Well, we actually don't play that much at home anymore. I mean, Europe is a big place.
It is.
So it keeps us busy in other countries except for our own. We actually just have two Swedish shows this summer. We played Bråvalla. It's a new festival, like huge festival in Sweden, first year, and it was amazing. Whenever we go home, it seems that the crowd is just getting bigger and bigger, even though we're not there anymore. We come like once a year, and the crowds are amazing. But I mean, Europe and especially Germany has been a good place for us from the beginning, you know? This is where we did the first tours outside of Sweden, in Germany, in 2010 with Do Nots.
So there's a special connection to the
Germans?
There's
a very special connection. This is easily the country where we spent the most time. And it's like a second home for us.
So you feel comfortable here?
We feel very comfortable.
You could even imagine to move to Germany.
Actually, Per has a girlfriend that comes from Münster.
Where did you find it? On tour? Or?
Where did you find it? I found her in Germany. No, I might move here. We'll see. I might move to Berlin because it's a really big, nice, cool city. But I'm not sure yet.
Okay,
I might stay in Sweden as well.
You just told them that you might move to Berlin, so everyone is waiting for you to become single again, and then all the girls from Saarland will move to Berlin.
Yeah.
You know, it'll just happen. Yeah?
Stand in line, I say.
Yeah.
This is the drummer we're talking about
here. For the rest of your life, you'll be happy.
See, I like to keep it long distance, so if I become single, I'll get a girlfriend in Sweden.
That doesn't sound very healthy, I guess. All you guys studied music, actually. You're just not only rock stars, but you studied music either to become a musician or a teacher. Is that kind of background what you need to become a successful rock star, or?
Stop saying rock star. I hate that word.
You hate it?
Yeah,
what do you
prefer? Musician. Musician fits better.
Yeah.
I don't like the whole rock star word. But anyway, I mean, it doesn't hurt. Some people think that studying music, you kind of remove the soul from the whole thing. You take away the passion and the glow and the heart and all that shit. I don't think that's necessarily true. Some people could use a bit more soul in their music, you know what I mean? But
you don't learn soul at school, right?
No, I mean, soul isn't something that you can learn, in my opinion. Either you have it or you don't. And practicing your craft and becoming a good musician, like knowing the theory and being able to read sheet music and communicating and talking to each other, is so much easier when we can just walk into a room and I can say, okay, I'm thinking this and this and this and that, and people just automatically know what to play, instead of walking over to Jonas and going, okay, so first it's this one and then it's this one two times, and then, you know, it's a lot easier when we can just go bam,
make it works. Okay. Yeah. Because I also think that you have to be the right kind of person, like actually to become famous and stay successful. And you have a nice image, I think. Like, you don't like the word, but you know, a rock star image, cocky a little bit, yeah? A little rednecky. Do you like that kind of style? Did I analyze it right? Or how would you describe your style yourself?
I don't know. No. I mean that's among the hardest things to do, to put a label on yourself, and nobody wants to do it, of course. Everybody's just like so special, and they're, no, I'm not that, I'm not this, I'm like my own thing. But I don't know, we're just us, and I don't really know where it came from. I mean, we wanted to be the Hives, and now we are.
Now you are. And they know, so the Hives don't work anymore. Another thing that might add to a successful career might be the styling, and you're usually famous for your, you know, hairdo like this. Now you have a hat on. I'm very disappointed, I have to say.
Yeah,
actually.
Really?
Yeah.
I think it's an awesome hat. I'm surprised by the things I've been famous for. Some people, like, in an interview, like, it's been the beard, and like, I've had some different styles of beard, and they were like, so you're famous for this, and then it was, you're famous for that, and then someone, it was like, so you're famous for your jeans. It's like, what? My jeans? You know? But I don't mind.
You don't mind?
I don't mind.
No,
you know,
at least it's a compliment.
Go ahead.
People like your hairdo. Yeah, I thought that I might like it too. So I brought a little bit of gel here. You know, it is. I've become a short-time member of Royal Republic.
Oh, really?
Would you do my hair just once? Show me how you prepare your hair for stage.
I can.
Yeah.
We would need a hair dryer for that, but I.
You wouldn't.
Let's do it without the hair dryer.
Okay, I'm just gonna get sticky.
Very sticky.
I'm gonna remove this ring.
Okay.
Only temporary. Okay. So we do this.
Oh, just a little.
All right.
Okay.
Just a little.
Also nicht viel nehmen.
Because we don't want to fuck up the volume. If
oh.
we have too much, it will just light up.
Yeah.
So, but this is already. What am I supposed to do with this? This is already like done. Let's fuck it.
It is, but it's not glossy yet. You should yeah oh
that's nice
my eyebrows
yeah there we go
on suck
yeah excellent okay so but this is like you have an awesome hairdo as it is that's just yeah,
I do I my hair is a little shorter than yours so
yes so I can't really but usually it takes me about 40 minutes to do my hair that sucks
40 minutes
yeah because I need to take a shower first and then I need to blow dry it like upside yeah. down and then I need to fucking comb it and spray it and it hurts and I still do it.
Is it glossy now? Does it shine?
No, but no. you shine as a person.
I shine as a person, yeah, that's what people tell me.
Right.
Because of my skin is very
so
shiny. I have something here for you. You're welcome. And I brought sunglasses with me. So, and I have a sweeter sentence that I learned, but I forgot. Hey, Detar Marek, Met Bandit, Royal Republic, Paul Halberg Open Air, right?
Very good.
Thank you very much. Okay, also die Regel ist, nicht allzu viel Gel zu nehmen. Ja, die Haare müssen frisch gewaschen sein morgens und dann klappt es auch mit dem perfekten Royal Republic Styling, haben wir gerade gelernt. Have much fun on stage. Yeah, have fun on stage. And
yeah.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you for
Royal
having
Republic.
Us.
Thank
Pleasure.
You very much.
Das 103.7 Unser Ding. Halberg Open Air 2013.